Welcome to Prerna Ke Srot. The channel has completed 2 months now, and we have met over a dozen of people, all of them beautifully inspiring people from different poles of life. And today, this channel is taking one of its social responsibility to bring more sensitivity towards the parents and the kids who are differently abled, who are blessed with a different talent. You and me, we only make the community, the society that we live in. So here is an attempt to bring forth a story of a child and a mother. So today, in this episode, we'll be meeting the mother. And in the next episode of Prerna Ke Srot, we would be meeting the duo, the mother and the child. The story of the mother is extremely inspiring. After having known that the child is suffering from a rare disease, a rare genetic disorder, she didn't succumb to the pressure. Rather, she trained herself, her mind, such that she was able to be around with the child when he needed her most. During this journey, not just she took care of the kid, but also looked after her own well-being, both physical, mental, and her own passions and hobbies that she just didn't leave behind. Today, she's a featured artist, she's a painter, she's a trained Bharatanatyam dancer, and also she learns Carnatic music. Her passion for life and her desire to continuously make a difference in her life, make it better each day, makes her the special person that she is. So let's welcome Mrs. Vijaya Kunapalli.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for accepting my invite to come on this platform.
I should thank you for giving me a chance to be on your platform and, you know, letting me bring out my feelings. And, you know, like, I want to share many things with mothers.
Yes,
yeah,
yes.
Definitely.
Absolutely. The idea here is to bring awareness towards the differently abled kids and how community should be more sensitive and empathetic towards them, the kids, the parents, the family members. So I would now request you to please let us know about your journey, how it has been.
I have two sons, actually. Mm-hmm. My eldest son is normal and he's doing well. This where the second child. Mm-hmm. He is born with a rare disease called Hirschsprung's disease. Mm-hmm. It is 1 in 1,000. Mm-hmm. It's like, it's a very rare case. Mm-hmm. So when he was born, on the third day, doctors felt that something is wrong with him. They felt that his, you know, stomach was extended and, you know, he's not taking any feed and he turned slightly blue. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. He is born with 6 fingers on his hand, left hand, okay, and 6 fingers on his left foot. Mm-hmm. So they, you know, generally, I believe babies born with some abnormality, they come along with other abnormalities. Mm-hmm. So doctors would have known and they were expecting. And they said then afterwards, of course, they did the tests and everything. They found out that he has to be operated. Mm-hmm. Because here, I don't want to really go very deep into the scientific part of this thing because it is very graphic. Mm-hmm. It's a very major operation and the pain and the things that are involved in that are very graphic for and very emotional and this thing also for me and for the listeners also. So mm-hmm. without going much deeper into the subject, I'll just cover the part of the operation part.
Yeah. But ma'am, I would like to tell the viewers, those who may not aware about Hirschsprung disease, this mm-hmm. is about the nerve cells in the colon, blood, intestine, which are missing. And that affects the passing of the stool. Mm. And which is why it was showing those signs in the baby when he was 3 days old, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the damaged part is generally, you know, taken off. Mm-hmm. And the intestines are again reconnected. Mm-hmm. So that is happens in this Hirschsprung's disease. Mm-hmm. The damaged part can be a small portion to a larger portion. Mm-hmm. So for my son, it so happened that he has a major portion of his large intestines were affected. So he had a major surgery, and so that's it. And they have to, since he's very small, first they'll do a small operation called colostomy, where they'll divert the intestine, and you know, when the baby is ready and little grown up, they'll do the major operation. And after that, after 3 months, again they'll close the colostomy and see that how it works. It's a very painful process, the whole thing, not only the operation. Afterwards, the child goes through a lot of, because he suffers, children will have diarrhea, and because large intestines, and I mean most of the intestines are, they don't work properly, the absorption of nutrients is very less for them. So like that, you know, they'll have many ailments, and you know, which come along with that. That's the thing. So because of that, he, you know, he used to have a lot of other ailments, like you know, he's always used to be anemic. We had to give him blood transfusion for 2 times, and you know, then he also had a rare disease called vasculitis, which affects, you know,
the heart.
Not only, no, it actually affects the what do you call, the smaller veins, you know, capillaries. And the people who have that, somehow it affects the heart. I don't know the scientific reason behind that, but whatever it is, he was he got that, and luckily he didn't affect his heart. Like that, he was almost every now and then, I mean, he's very often in and out of hospitals.
So then you mentioned about the child going through a disability as far as his vision was concerned. When did you realize that, you know, that he's not able to see properly?
Yeah, we realized that when he's around 6, because his we thought that he's not able to see the, some things he'll find out. We'll ask him to get a book. He'll see sometimes, no, he can't find it on the table. It is just there, but because already he's having the tubular vision. So then slowly we came to, I mean, we never thought it is a such a big this thing. But I thought, you know, maybe some sight problem or something. So when we took him to the doctor, they diagnosed him with another rare disease called retinitis pigmentosa. But him, I think it came along with this.
This also is a genetic disorder, retinitis pigmentosa, wherein gradual decline of the vision happens. For those who are affected by this disorder, right? So most people would crack under the pressure when a 3-year-old kid is getting surgery, you know, then he's getting operated. And then, as you mentioned, there were a series of operations that he had to undergo, you know. And now this pigmentosa, which caused the lack of vision for him, how did you, you know, how did you manage it? You know, you've come out so strong today. He is pretty brilliantly doing what he's doing in the field of music. So how did you manage yourself that time?
Yeah, it was a very emotional and traumatic journey for both of us. I can't deny that it is very, very traumatic. But like all mothers, you know, we can't let it go. We have to fight for our children. So I think that kept me on. And when he lost the vision, that was a major blow. I took very long, it took very long for me to accept that fact. because unless I am strong, I cannot support him. So I had to be, real rock strong for him, so that I won't show my any emotions, with him. Then I can carry on with my job. See, I am neither a god nor a doctor who can help him with anything. Then I decided whatever I can do as a mother. So what is in my hands, I will do it 100% or more for him. That was my this thing.
That's the biggest strength, that you have as an individual, that you stood with him like a rock, as you said. So from when he turned visually challenged, and still you did not give up, as you were mentioning earlier, that you ensured that he studies. So from him become visually challenged to completing his 10th and 12th in schooling with science as a subject, as a stream, which is quite a bold decision for you to take for him. And later on, his education till about master's in philosophy. So how did you manage all this, and how was he coping with the kids around in the school?
It was the education part of him is very, very difficult for me. Because, see, if a child is born blind, they are in a way they're from the beginning, they'll be sent to a blind school. They'll teach them everything, how to cope with, how to walk around, things around and all that. But for Anupam, unfortunately, he is not born blind. He could see. And though he was losing a little bit, but still he could see, then a child losing all that, and he used to have not only the peripheral vision, and the vision, suppose you keep your fingers like this, how you will see. Some parts of your vision are blocked. So to cope with that is more difficult than being blind, I tell you, because the levels are different, and they go colorblind and all these things. And for a child who could see normally, and losing it is very, very difficult.
Very traumatic.
And to handle him at this stage was very difficult for me. Emotionally, we both were crumbling, actually.
Mm-hmm. So what worked for you? How did you get the strength to, one, to pull yourself out of this situation, and two, to take your child forward and always keep him motivated to study more and not give up on anything in life?
I think I had to do it, I can't give up on my child. If a mother can't do, who can else do? So then I had to take him off from the regular school and tried him in another school to calm him down. So there are no pressures with other children, competing and things. That school helped him a lot in the beginning when he was small. But when he is coming to the bigger classes, from 8th to 9th, the school didn't help much, because it's basically a school for the slow learners. And they wouldn't know how to, teach and take them up to higher levels. Then I said, this school, sending him to school and all, though initially had helped him, but I'll be wasting my time sending, because anyway, I have to teach him at home. So I took him off from that school also. But through that school, you can appear privately to this Indira Gandhi University open school is there. So there they'll give you a few subjects. Like, they have to do everything like other children, except that you don't have too many languages. You can select either one language, English or whatever. It's like that. So teaching him that was my biggest challenge, because children learn from, A for ant, the next UKG again they'll start with A for ant for 3 months, and again they'll go. The whole year they'll be doing the same things repeatedly. So that thing is not possible when you are teaching a child. who is appearing privately, because they the subject you have to, suppose biology or something, you have to start with, you know, plant life and animal life from leaf to, then you are going up to so high in higher up, like, you know, the concept is the every year, like if, what you cover in 10 years, you have to cover it in 6 months' time, or even maybe less than that. But that is the biggest challenge for me. So to make him understand, I have to teach also, no? Make him understand. And you know the children, and for a boy who is losing his sight, he's always irritable and, you know, emotionally down, and, you know, he cannot play with other children and all that. To make him study is even more, it was much harder than
that. Yeah, and on top of that, you chose science as a stream. So how did you manage teaching him those concepts?
Like I used to take, you know, atta and make small balls and take matchsticks and, you know, explain him with that. The chemical bonds, how they are made, and molecules, how they, you know, all those things like that I used to use and teach him. So
but you were an art student when you studied your graduation, and here you were teaching science to a 10th 12th grader.
But yeah, of course this is basic science, so I think everyone, we also had covered, you know, in school.
Okay,
that wasn't a problem. But only when in 11th and 12th was a little more difficult, because those are the CBSE syllabus only they give. It's not something easy just because some people are doing it privately. It's not like that. See, it's not meant any, it's not designed for any visually challenged or any other people. It's not like that. It is for normal people only. Mm-hmm. Anybody who cannot attend a normal school, you can do this, appear to, appear the 10th exam and 11th and 12th. It's like that. So the concepts when you reach 11th and 12th are very, very difficult, because sometimes I had to take the help of my elder son in asking the nuclear fission, nuclear fusion, and all those, and some formulas and things like that.
So how was his social adjustment going on in school and in the community where you were living, and how was all that?
It was pretty bad, I should say, like in the beginning. I mean, because children won't play with him. He can't play, like he can't see the ball. He can't play cricket and all. So like that, you know, once I asked him why you are still playing with these He-Man toys and all. He said, Mom, I can't see. I can't play cricket and all with other boys. So I have to play with this. Then I said, I must start playing with him. So I used to take him and play cricket and make him play the full basketball and everything. And at the time he was very small, like 8, 10. So the other children, you know, when he is playing with me like that, then they slowly used to come and ask me, Auntie, can we also play with Anupam? I said, yes, sure, please come. So I used to bowl for them also. And because we make them, you know, hit shots and all, you know, so they used to enjoy that game with him. And slowly he has been accepted by other children and he used to play with them. Mm-hmm. Same thing when he grew up, you know, just with basketball and either with swimming. I used to take him for the swimming classes also. I used to take him myself and with a floater. He had learned, he's a very good swimmer now. underwater, everything he'll swim now, but I can't swim. That is the thing.
So mother is the first guru of a child, and you proved it to the last point, to the last T, you proved it that yes, you're the first guru of the child who taught him not just science concepts, but swimming, cricket, basketball and everything. So I really want to, you know, say a big thank you to you for being so strong, because today you're here as a source of motivation and inspiration to a lot of other mothers who have such, you know, specially or differently abled kids. And they can actually learn a lesson from you here, that how you led your life with the kid and how you took it forward by setting an example for all of us to follow. Not just, you know, people with specially abled kids, but for the random, the normal parents also. So,
like many, I think it comes with the acceptance. Because the first problem comes when you can't accept that your child is having some problem. You have to, you know, bring yourself to accept that. Then only you can help the child and help yourself, you know. As so long as you are having a sort of denial to yourself, you cannot do any help, you cannot help anybody. So with the child, you have to first accept. And that, I think that makes a lot of difference. Many, I heard, but I haven't seen. For me, I feel every mother wants to help their children. But some of the other blind students I met through him, they used to tell me that, Auntie, you are so supportive to Anupam and all. My parents, you know, they don't behave like that. They feel so ashamed that, you know, we are born like this. You know, that I myself personally, I haven't seen anyone. But they used to tell me. So I think that's where the parents, especially mother, has to be strong. Accept. I think being born as with some difficulty or disability is not anything that you have to feel ashamed of. There are other children who are born completely normal and not doing anything, you know. I think that is where parents have to feel, you know, ashamed of their children or whatever. But see, this is a chance that the destiny throws at you. So I don't think you have to feel ashamed of yourself. That I strongly would like to, you know, tell other mothers, if at all they are feeling anything like that.
Yeah, I remember, ma'am, when we first interacted about your experience, you mentioned that there was a time that you felt, you actually diagnosed your own depression. You diagnosed that you are going through this, and you took the courage to reach out for, you know, for seeking help, professional help. So just share something from that experience of yours.
Yeah, before that, I need to tell you, I mean, as it is stressful to any mother to handle a disabled child. But my routine used to be, you know, like morning I get up, take a walk, and I have to prepare something by 7 o'clock, you know, 6:30 itself for my eldest son. He goes to college. And then I have to make some breakfast for my husband. Then I'll make this fellow do yoga and teach him slokas. And then give him breakfast. I'll have my breakfast. After that, then we read papers, newspaper to him. Then I quickly, you know, used to finish my cooking and everything. He'll have his bath and all. Then we sit down for studies at 10:30. And then till 1:30, because 1:30 again my husband will come from office and we'll have lunch. Then I'll have a small break, you know, small rest for a small time, like an hour or so. Then I used to take him for his games. You know, I used to make him play cricket or basketball, whatever. Then come back, make something for my son who will come back hungry from college, you know. And my husband will come back. Then cook the dinner. And night after dinner, again, I'll read some storybooks to him. And that kind of long, very long day, you know, fully it is. And in between, I am a normal housewife, you know. And we are not very rich, so that I can have so many servants around helping me. And on top of it, I used to have a lot of guests. from our extended families coming and going. I mean, each almost every month we used to have a lot of guests, attending to them, attending to their, to his studies.
That must have been very stressful for you.
That was very stressful.
There was a trauma because of the child's health. And then there is this, you know, on the top of it, there is everything else that you have to do.
Yeah.
It must have been very
that
stressful.
I think made, because I wanted to still go on, but I think, our body restricts our this thing, it has its own limits. So it shows its things in some way or the other. Then I happened to read some symptoms in Hindu paper. In those days, not so much of network and all the internet and all. So then they gave, a few things like stuttering and, frequent, depression sense, crying and other things, So all these things, then I noticed I'm going through something and which I have to rectify myself. Till then, I never realized that I was having, why all this is happening to me. Then, luckily, one of my friend's husband is a doctor. He's a counselor. He's actually a marriage counselor. But he gave me another doctor, his name, psychiatrist. Mm-hmm. Then I went and met him, and he said, listening all to my story, he said, you definitely need, because there are chemical transmitters that they can take only that much. They will go down after that. They will, like battery, once it is off means off. You have to recharge them. So clinically, you have to be treated. So I used to take medicines. Then almost for 1 year I took. And I was taking medicines for my this thing. Then I was teaching him for his 11th and 12th.
Wonderful. This requires a lot of courage, to be able to, as you said, that first we need to become aware. And in your case, you have been very much aware about yourself, your own body, mind, and also with your child, because you had to do a lot of stuff with him together. So it was important for you to keep yourself fit so you're able to, help him, right?
If I am not fit, I cannot help him. So that is the main thing.
True. So ma'am, one message that you'd like to give to people, to parents out there, though you've mentioned that first thing is acceptance. What else would you like to share to the community? Because this is the reason why we are here, to bring that awareness in people.
Yeah. See, for mothers, just acceptance, and you accept your child, whatever it is, and love them. And never lose hope. There is always hope, and always better things are there for you. Because nowadays, a lot of help is there. Even when he was small, I couldn't find many counselors and all for him. But now, for autistic children, for so many disabilities, you find help very easily nowadays. Okay. So I think they need not become feel helpless or anything. Mm. There will be help somewhere.
Definitely. Yeah. So today, Anupam is a lyricist. He's a composer. He loves to make fusion with jazz and Carnatic music. He's a YouTuber. Mm-hmm. He has an own channel. He keeps publishing some or the other new music every day. Which one is your favorite of his work that he's done so far? Mm-hmm.
he's still actually in the making, I should say. I like one or two songs of his. Road to Rajasthan. I feel it's very nice.
Very soulful. I've heard that album. So I want to tell the viewers that the music that you heard in the beginning of this session and what you will hear towards the end, it has been composed by Anupam himself. I would request you all to please go Google him find him on YouTube and please like and subscribe to his channel and follow him with all your love and support that you can. And I wish to thank you, ma'am, for coming to this to our platform wherein we really wanted people to know more about you and Anupam.
But more than actually mothers of the disabled, I would like to give a message to the community, you said, like normal people. Because, see, people are very judgmental. They say that, oh, he is like that. You know, when Anupam is small, they used to think, maybe still they think that he is not intelligent. No, he doesn't know any maths. He doesn't know any of these things. So, it's like that. You know, you mark him something. And with me also, like they say, oh, she is very lazy. She doesn't pursue things, you know, properly till the end or something. They're quite judgmental. I think that is, you have to be sensitive to the child, you know, sort of this kind of children, and show empathy. If not, you know, if you need not help them or anything, at least try, don't judge them.
Correct.
Because what all, I don't think I am a loser or anything. Because I have still doing all this. I have learned Carnatic music. I sang in Thiruvayaru and, you know, near the Tyagaraja temple also I could sing. And not only in my young age, of course, I sang. But even then, afterwards, I had learned classical music. Mm-hmm. Then those degrees, you know, they used to say, why don't you write? You are only teaching. You also could have got 2 degrees. I said, what will I do with those 2 degrees? What will I? I don't care whether I have 2 degrees. His degrees are mine only.
He is your biggest degree. I would say the biggest medal that you can actually flaunt with a lot of pride. And I want to tell the viewers also that you are a featured artist. So your paintings are getting featured. So please tell us about that.
Yeah. One Miss Isha Philip from Bangalore, actually, she is. Mm-hmm. She is a very good artist and a gold medalist herself. Mm-hmm. And somehow she liked my paintings. I'm so happy that she, in her catalog, she's featured my paintings. Mm-hmm. And she, one of my paintings also has been selected for Indo-Taiwan virtual show, which is going to happen next month, I think. This March 20th, I think, to April 20th. You can see it online.
Beautiful. My heartiest congratulations to you, ma'am. You've proved that, you know, when people tag you with some particular thing, saying that this is, you know, you have a differently abled child or you're not doing enough for yourself. You could have done much better. You have so much talent. And still here for you, who were very quietly working towards, you know, your goal of raising him independently. And what a beautiful child he is today. He's a grown up 36-year-old man now who makes beautiful music. And here you are, who's making your mark in the field of painting.
That's only God's grace.
Now, all your hard work also, ma'am. So I wish you loads of luck and success. And all those people watching this session, please go explore more about ma'am Vijaya Raghavi Kunnapilli, and both of them are there on the social media platforms. Please like, subscribe and follow them and show them your love. Thank you so much for joining us today, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.